You're listening to a Weeby Geeks Network podcast.
Another world, another time, in the age of wonder.
There was once a dream. You could only whisper it. Anything more than a whisper, and it would vanish.
A battle between good and evil.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
Where shall I find a new adversary so close to my own level?
Try the local sewer.
You know of the rebellion against the Empire?
The Avengers, Earth's mightiest heroes.
Peace means having a bigger stick than the other guy.
One of these days, I'm gonna have a stick of my own.
I'm Groot.
Welcome to the Neverland podcast. The podcast for lovers of Disney, Pixar, Marvel, and Star Wars.
I'm glad you're here to tell us these things.
Please welcome your host, Jeremy.
I thought he'd be taller.
Yeah, I can fly.
All it takes is faith and trust.
Well, if it isn't the Star Spangled Man with a plan, what is your plan today?
Up to Neverland!
America, a land where eagles soar. Since history began, its people have celebrated the magnificence of this land. Tonight, we celebrate America, a land of many people, a country that continues to grow. Nation of courage and independence. America, the beautiful. Independence Day, we welcome you to our 4th of July celebration as we commemorate the birthday of this great nation. With joy, we celebrate the United States of America, a vast mosaic of individuality and inspiration, a vibrant palette of cultures and colors, a country whose pioneering spirit continues to live on in the hearts and minds of people who cherish freedom in this land and around the globe.
God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
Take your pixie out of your pockets, Neverlanders, and of course, sprinkle some of that pixie dust around, think up your happiest thought, and let's fly away to Neverland. I, of course, am your head Lost Boy Jeremy, but you can call me Spider-Pan because all of us Lost Boys around here have nicknames. And you know what? We even have nicknames for the pixies, too. Why do we have pixies? Because girls are too clever and they don't get lost. Now, of course, if you want to have an official nickname, please visit our website, neverlandpodcast.com, and go into the Neverlanders page, where there you can fill out a form if the website is working. I have been having problems once again with HostGator trying to get my website back up. It has been down for nearly a month. I've done about all I can, and hopefully, though, by the end of this week, it will be back up. But, of course, you can still visit us at weebiegeeks.com if you want to look at show notes or anything like that. Or when you download the episode, you should get some show notes even there. But, yes, I've been having that problem, and, yes, I've been aware of it. And hopefully it will be fixed very soon. I'm paying an extra fee over to HostGator to try to restore the website. It's been a mess. It's been a real hassle. But on some other lighter and more fun things, If you happen to have a Nintendo Switch, both Eric and I have been playing one. I got one for my 42nd birthday. I went and kind of got one for myself. Eric has recently acquired one. We're both playing Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. And based upon how much Eric is playing it, I think he's enjoying it as much as I am. It's very different from the Zelda games that you're used to. But it's just good, you know? It's just fun. You kind of just wander. It's a huge world, and it's challenging. But I'm also having a lot of fun. We've gotten Stardew Valley. If you've never heard of that, go look it up. It's very retro style, the way it looks, but it's just a nice, patient, feel-good kind of game. Stardew Valley. I'm having a lot of fun playing that. Also, I've recently acquired Mario Kart 8 Deluxe for the Nintendo Switch. And if you'd like to be able to play with me, I think at some point I should give you my friend ID number, or heck, email it to me, podcast@neverlandpodcast.com, and you get a friend request from me, and then maybe we can play some Mario Kart together or something sometime. Even Stardew Valley, apparently you can play, make a farm together somehow or another. I'm still figuring all of that out, but we're just having a grand old time playing, and I'm sure Eric would probably like to play with you as well. I'm hoping he gets Mario Kart sometime so I can race him, because I'm having a lot of fun with this new Mario Kart. But that's what's going on in my world right now. But this week's episode is going to be a little different because it's a holiday week and I kind of want to take a bit of a week off. So although I'm working July 4th, you know, I work in radio and radio doesn't stop. And I work at two different stations. I fill in on one and then I work regularly on another. And the place where I fill in, their regular person wanted to have the evening off on the July 4th. And so I'm going to go ahead and work it for him. So I'll be working on July 4th. The nice thing is some of the communities nearby me will have a fireworks display on July 3rd, and we usually go to one up in Kearney, Missouri. So on July 3rd, I'll go get to enjoy some fireworks and some fun, and then July 4th, I'll be working, but that's okay. I need the money, and, you know, I'm showing this other station that I'm willing to work and being there. So I'm still working my way to get more of a full-time type of position where they have more for me to do. And of course, I'm, you know, branding myself and, you know, trying to get to where I have more of a show that would be mine would be great, because right now what I'm doing, I do a lot of news, and the news that I read sometimes is very tragic, and I think it's taking its toll on me. I took out a section a couple of shows ago where I kind of went on about some of the sad things going on, but I don't want to really dwell on those, so I don't really want to tell you. But I tell you, going and doing news, you have so much things, some very tragic things, but there is one nice positive story I'd like to share with you, and maybe keep this person in your prayers. But this officer, Jasmine Diab, or Diab, it's D-I-A-B, so I've been calling her Diab, but she was injured in the line of duty. She was shot and was lucky to have survived. She's moving into a therapy phase of her recovery, but the small town where she's from, Trenton, is going to have a blue smoke event at 105 on July 4th. 105 is, of course, it's her badge number, so doing it 105 in the afternoon, what they thought would be appropriate. But it's just a nice story because she's going to be okay, and she's recovering, and the community's come together on this, and they've got a GoFundMe up for her. So I've been able to follow this story for the last couple of weeks since she was shot, and having her survive that. So you know what? That makes me feel good when I get stories like that, because there's so much tragedy going on, even in small towns. And so many terrible things happen, and it's now part of my job to have to report it. And I know it's taking its toll on me. It's very sad. So I'm hoping I can get more into a position where I'm doing a type of radio where I don't have to worry about those. You know, I wouldn't mind doing something, a wacky more type of show where maybe I get to talk about some weird news and stuff like that. So I'm working my way hopefully that direction to make myself into more of a brand, kind of like what I'm doing here with the podcast. And you know what? I would like to take this podcast in maybe a bit more fun and wackier directions. We're coming up on 300 episodes. Somewhere in the back of my head has thought almost to stop at 300. Like, you know, I'm not growing as fast as I would like. This show is not as big as I would like it to be. And sometimes I feel like the best way people manage to grow their podcast is by a lot of copyright infringement or celebrity guests. And I wouldn't mind some more celebrity guest interviews. You know, it's difficult to sometimes to line those up. You have to know some people who know people or whatever. And so that's kind of a challenge. And I've always just wanted the show to be fun. But the other thought that I've had is, other than instead of stopping at 300, we're just going to maybe change things up a little bit. And maybe the show will become a little bit more wackier. And maybe you have a few extra goofy sound clips that will come along. I think I just cued myself for one right there. So, but we're, you know, I want to just make sure we're having as much fun as possible. And go ahead, and if you have not reviewed the show on iTunes, please do so. It just takes you a couple of minutes. Share the show with others and everything. I want this to be a big community. And, you know, come and join us on Facebook and have some fun. I'm working on, we've got a Discord server. I haven't done a whole lot with it. I would like to have some more fun on that. Maybe we could have some hangouts on Discord or something. You know, I want to be more interactive with you and have some fun with you. And I wanted this show to be just, you know, you have a good time when you come here. That's kind of the goal. And the other things that have been going through my head here lately is I'm coming up on 10 years since I've been on my one and only Disney trip. And I feel like part of that Disney magic is leaving me a little bit. Because, I mean, it's been 10 years. And so, you know, I'm interested in a lot of other things other than Disney. And we like to cover a lot of different things here. You know, we have a lot of things that are fun. And I want to have some more retro-style fun and talk about some fun stuff we did in the past. So, coming up with, you know, this, we're coming up and completing 6 years of this, you know, coming up after episode 300 or even going into episode 300, I think I want to focus a little bit more and have more just fun and just fun conversations like that. Eric and I can have a lot of fun with conversations and even bringing in some other friends and stuff. I think we're just going to have more fun here and talk about some retro things. And I have some really fun topics that are in my head that I would like to do that I think Eric and I can have a lot of fun discussing. So I haven't dropped all these topics on him yet, but I think we're going to have some fun with some of the ideas I have in mind. So we're aiming just to make a fun show. And if you have like some fun ideas or something you'd like us to talk about and you think it would be fun, send us an email, podcast@neverlandpodcast.com. I mean, you are part of this. I'm in your ears right now, but you are, of course, part of this. All right, however long you've been with me, if you've gone back and listened to the old shows and worked your way up at some point, or you just were there at the very beginning, however you've come along, you are a part of this. Welcome to the community. You've been part of it, so I don't necessarily need to say welcome, but you know, I just have this vision of what this should be and how much fun I want to have. And this is like my refuge, coming here and doing this, and I want it to be a refuge for you to just have some fun and have a good time. And I think I've said having some fun way too many times. But anyways, let's just get into it. I've been babbling long enough, like for 8 minutes now. This is going to be a special show. I have the second half of my interview with Gary Wood. And let me just remind you, he did a really fun little comedy film called Saving Star Wars, which basically the plot line is two Star Wars fans who accidentally kidnapped George Lucas. It's available to view on YouTube. He premiered this at, I think, Star Wars Celebration 3. It's a lot of fun. So we talk a little bit about the making of that, and he's also going to talk about a Steve Martin documentary he's working on, which should be a lot of fun and also very funny. So there's a lot of other things going on, but it was a fun conversation, so I'll bring you that first. But then for the rest of the show, I want to celebrate America. Even if you don't live in the United States, you can skip the second half if you really want to. But I'm going to share some audio from Epcot, The American Journey, some Star audio from 2018. So I think it is the current version of it. So we're going to listen to that and enjoy that as well as we celebrate the holiday. But you've heard enough of me just talking to you directly. Sit back, relax, and enjoy listening to me talking with Mr. Gary Wood.
To Disney and beyond.
I am now 55 years old. I made Saving Star Wars 15 years ago. So that was my first, first full-length movie. Really my first, I don't think I even made any shorts before then. I think the only thing I made before then was I did a murder mystery show at a comedy club that I was working at. And I basically filmed the resolution to the comedy club or the murder mystery. So kind of like, and I think I filmed a little preview too that kind of set things up like of all the who could have done it. And then the audience had to like guess it, guess who did it or whatever. So, and that was the first thing I shot. And my first editing, but I edited it all on VHS. I shot on VHS and edited. Oof. Edited. I can't even say the word edited. Is that good?
Yeah.
I edited it. Anyway, so so that's probably the only thing I've actually shot, wrote, and shot. And then Saving Star Wars full length feature film. And at the time, I'm like, well, to me, it takes just as much effort and crew and time to shoot, not time, but to shoot a feature as it does to shoot a short. What I found was that, and when you're done, you have a feature as opposed to a short, which, is not a lot of back end on a short, get to watch it in movie theaters, you know, but it's 5-10 minutes. What I didn't anticipate, of course, like I said, was the momentum keeping it going. We couldn't afford to not have day jobs, you know, so we right. only shoot on the week. And that goes for the entire cast. They all had, I mean, we had, like I said, Scott was a Rolls-Royce executive. We had students, you know, we had, I think she works for Mary Kay. I had a, Jim Peterson is a drama teacher at a high school. coincidentally, again, huge coincidence. He was the drama teacher at the high school that Jake Lloyd went to.
Wow.
I know. Crazy, right? So, and here's a little, here's another little anecdote that I don't think I've ever told anybody this, but Jim, you know, drama teacher, they've got a performing arts theater, right? Mm. We were supposed to have a song and dance number in this movie, too. All right. And it was going to be, you know, Rock Me Amadeus. And it was going to be kind of like they're all running from the hotel. They're running and they find themselves kind of on stage. Very similar. If you remember Wayne's World 2, I think it was, where they were all dressed up like, well, basically the village people, but unintentionally. And they find themselves on stage in front of a crowd and they just right. start doing it. So kind of that similar. Similar scene with Rock Me Amadeus. Well, Jim, you know, works at the high school, and he's like, yeah, let's do it. Let's just do it there. I'm like, okay, cool. Well, you know, he put it on his calendar and everything, and certain people got wind of it, and of course, Mrs. Lloyd got wind of it that it was Saving Star Wars, you know, and like, oh, it's Star Wars related. So clearly this has to be because my son goes to school. That's why they're doing it. But there's no way in the world you're going to get them to believe that it's not.
Yeah.
You know? No, I wasn't, right? So I get a call from Jim, and he's like, man, he goes, I just got reamed. And he goes, yeah, we can't do it. And
you know,
it's like Jake Lloyd's mom came in talking to the superintendent, just pitching a fit, blah, blah, blah. And in her defense, I know that, well, one, he's gotten kicked out of a couple different schools. He got kicked out of a private school because he's kind of a D-bag.
Yeah, I've heard.
You know, but she also has to protect him because he had plenty of pedophiles that had, you know, bounties on his head and stuff Ooh. Like that. So there's all that. So I get, you know, she got to be protective. But, you know, simple conversation would have solved this, right?
So and she might have been asked Jake if, you know, Jake might have wanted to pop up and have a cameo.
Yeah, I'm like, hey, I'm not saying he can be in it, you know. Mm. I'm just saying that wasn't our goal, and I'm not even saying, you know, hey, does he want to be in it? I'm just, you know, but I'm, you know, it's sure if that's what it amounts to. But I didn't even put that out there, right? It wasn't even about him. It was about we have a – just coincidentally, Jim is our – you know, one of the leads, and he's the drama teacher at that high school that since he got kicked out of the private school, he's now in the public school. And, you know, so what ended up happening was I ended up calling the superintendent of this high school, and I said, yeah, I said, I understand we ran into a little bit of an issue. I said, I know you know, I guess we can't do it. And he's like, yeah, we can't really, you know, insurance and blah, 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 and liability and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, well, yeah, but I know that, you know, Jake Lloyd's mom came in and I guess she had some concerns. I said, I'd be glad to talk to her. And he goes, who?
Oh, boy.
Yeah. I go, Jake Lloyd's mom. He goes, who's Jake Lloyd? I go, Jake Lloyd is a student at your school. He goes, oh, well, we've got a lot of students, so I'm unfortunately not familiar with everyone or know all of their names and this and that. And I said, well, first of all, you've talked to his mom from what I've heard, so I think you'd remember. Second of all, this kid was in Star Wars. And I find it very, very hard to believe that you weren't aware of him coming to your school before he arrived. I'm sure there were conversations with his parents. I'm sure there was conversations with him. I'm sure this was a big, big deal.
Yeah.
And he's like, well, no. He goes, and I kind of feel like you're calling me a liar. I said, well, I kind of feel like you're lying to me. And he's like, well, he goes, I don't think I'd be calling someone a liar who could potentially help you get to other schools if you knew the other schools. And I said, you're misunderstanding me at this point. At this point, you've lied to me, and I don't want your help. I said, I can get other schools just fine. I don't trust you. I wouldn't trust you. There'd be strings attached. And I said, there's no way in the world that you do not know who Jake Lloyd is. He's a student in your school. There's no way in the world. And I said, so at this point in time, I appreciate your time. I don't want to shoot at your school. And I don't want your help because you're a liar. You know, so just another weird anecdote stuff that happened during the making of this thing. So, you know, and I know, you know, hey, Jake grew up, you know, as a child actor, and 9 times out of 10 that never goes well.
Yeah.
The reason why he settled in Indianapolis was because they shot Madison down in southern Indiana, and they liked the area, and I think he also needed to be, you know, kind of disappear because of all the, you know, those pedophiles and all the things that were people that were seeking him out.
That's unfortunate.
I get it that it's hard. It would be hard to believe that your son who was in Star Wars goes to high school and then all of a sudden this low budget fan film based on Star Wars is filming in his high school. And it's unrelated, but it totally was, you know, so very, very odd, you know?
Yeah. But back on what you were saying about how Star Wars is like a bonding thing with the father and son in the film, that works still in real life. The funny thing is my wife now, when we were still kind of friends, still trying to figure out what we were, we actually waited in lines to get tickets for The Phantom Menace, and we went to that film together. We've been to every Star Wars film since together. So it has awesome. Been a bonding thing. I've been married 16 years now from Star Wars.
There you go. Yeah. So you guys celebrate your anniversaries depending on which Star Wars film is out. Yeah, that was our Rogue One anniversary.
Although I don't think she went to the theater. She didn't go to the theater with me to see Solo, though.
Really?
She didn't see that one until I bought a copy of that one.
Okay.
So
well, let me give you my real big Solo. The Star Wars. Oh, my God. Okay. So, oh, gosh. How do I put this? Okay. I went to see it at the theater, right? Mm-hmm. And it was good. I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
There was so many morons being butthurt over The Last Jedi, you know, that they, you know, they boycotted. And then these people, these fans, you know, they get it on video and they go, wow, it's actually pretty good.
Yeah.
You know, it's not great. I mean, it's not the best at all, you know.
But it's fun.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I still had fun, even though somebody pulled the fire alarm halfway through the movie and we all got ushered out of the theater. And we had to come back in, and they had to back the movie up about 15 minutes to try to get us all in there. So it took me about 3 hours to watch that movie.
Wow. That sucks. But
it made it memorable.
I could have done with some of the backstory silliness. I could have done without, you know, like how he got his name Solo. It was kind of cheesy, and
it was. You know, cheese works in Star Wars.
yeah. But you know what? But some of it was like, you know, tell you what, you know, now Han has shot first twice.
Yeah, there you go.
And I think that was amazing. It was so
good.
I just think it just got a bum rap. And
yeah.
The biggest problem to me wasn't the boycotts. The biggest problem was Star Wars is no longer a summer film, and the summers are now packed. You know,
I mean, are they?
It came out. I don't remember the chronology, but it was Star Wars was battling, you know, up against what was it? Infinity War, maybe? Was it Infinity War? It was one of the Marvels.
It wouldn't battle with Disney that tries not to compete with themselves now. It wouldn't necessarily be a competition.
Right. And Deadpool 2 and Jurassic Park and it was in the middle of all that. And yeah, Star Wars always made its massive money through repeat viewings.
Yeah.
But when you got Star Wars and Marvel and Deadpool and Jurassic Park, and you know, people are going to be seeing all those movies. They're not going to be going to see Star Wars 2 and 3 and 4 times. Now, had they, you know, had some patience and wait and released it in for Christmas like they had been. I get they wanted to hit that May 25th date, but May 25th isn't the same as it used to be, you know, in terms of movie. If they'd waited,
Marvel owns May now.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And so if they'd waited till Christmas, when January and February are typically dead months, although February is coming on, you know, stronger these days, but that's when you're going to get those repeat viewings. You know, that's when there's nothing really out coming in January. So, hey, let's go see Star Wars again. You know, plus you're also dealing with Netflix and all that too.
Yeah.
You know, but I think the biggest issue with it was not the script. It wasn't the movie. It wasn't the fans. It was just bad scheduling, you know?
Yeah, and could be.
I personally would have said this is a bad idea, but now they know. And hopefully they know. Hopefully they looked at it and go, yeah, we actually blundered that one. And it wasn't all this other stuff that we're giving attention to, you know? And unless Kathleen Kennedy had something to do with the scheduling, which I'm sure she did, it wasn't her fault. You know, she made the best movie that they can make, and it wasn't a horrible movie. And the people that were boycotting it have watched it now and actually realize it's pretty fun. And the guy that played Solo was really good.
He did a pretty good job.
Fun. Yeah.
I can accept him.
And, yeah. And, oh gosh, what's his name? The played Lando.
He stole that movie, man. He was awesome.
he was so good. And my God.
Glover. Donald Glover, I think it was.
And how can you not love Chewbacca in that movie, you know? And then seeing them, and that was just so much fun, you know?
Yeah.
So I kind of felt like, had that movie been bigger and done better? And by the way, it wasn't a flop. They call it Star Wars' first flop. It wasn't a flop. It made money. It made its money back. It made the money. By Star Wars standards, yeah, it was low. But by
but it was old it wasn't a saga standards. Film, so
exactly
it was a side film.
Yeah, so it wasn't as bad as they say. So anyway, Saving Star Wars is about two Star Wars fans that accidentally kidnapped George Lucas. I don't know if it's funny.
It's just a goofball comedy. It's just silly, and it's, you know, the fact that it's, you know, you can see that the budget was low, the cinematography is not great, the acting is not great, some of the camera angles are not great, the lighting is terrible at times.
Sound is awful.
Yeah. But it did remind me a lot. I actually made a little fan film that's up on YouTube that would be a copyright infringement for every episode. I released it in bits called Supers, and it was me and my friend kind of making fun of Marvel's Civil War back when the comics had come out before the film, long before the film. Right. But we crossed it over into having like DC Universe characters in there. And it was supposed to be 5 years after it was illegal to be a superhero. And I'm playing Spider-Man overweight. My buddy's playing an overweight Superman. And we're both secretly trying to come out of retirement to go to stop Iron Man, who's also out of overweight because he's commercialized the entire thing. And it's just
that
screwball.
Sounds super.
Yeah. That's the costumes are terrible on purpose. I wanted it to feel like a slacker Clerks film. You know, and then, of course, everything is very cheaply done, but we thought that's what added to the charm of the film. So, it's about an hour running time. So,
well, I will say this, and you're probably in the same boat. The best compliment that I got for Saving Star Wars was from the director of the London Science Fiction Film Festival. Not only did I drag my feet, I submitted the movie application, but I didn't send in the movie. I get a call from London. And this guy, Louis Savvy, is just an amazing guy. Now it's called Sci-Fi London. He's got Sci-Fi Dubai. He's got Sci-Fi Boston, I believe. He's all over the place. And so he's amazing. He calls me up and he's like, you know, in his British accent, he's like, you know, I never do this. He goes, you apply, you know, fill out the application, don't send your film. I don't care. He says, but I want to see your movie.
There you go.
Like, yeah, two Star Wars fans kidnap George Lucas. Oh, accidentally? I want to know how that worked out. So I'm like,
yeah, tie him up with dental floss.
Yeah. Well, you know, what's the ad? So, is this my dinner? That's my one of my favorite films. Is this my dinner? Like George Lucas is worried about his dental floss. Okay. But so I said, okay, I sent it to him. So he sees it and he goes, I got to tell you, you're in. He goes, and I had to pull rank on this one. He goes, everyone on my selection board said no. I finally had to say, it's my festival and Saving Star Wars is going to play at my festival.
There you
and
go.
The best compliment that he gave us was, he goes, it's true that technically the film is less than 100%. He said, but the content is like 110, 120.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it is. As long as people are laughing, as long as people are engaging with the characters and the story, they're very forgiving about the technical flaws.
Right.
I don't know that you can say the same for a drama or an action film, you know? All those technical aspects are more important, I think, but as long as they're laughing, they're forgiving, you know? And
yeah,
my favorite thing is to watch it with the crowd because I don't want to spoil it for anybody guys who've seen it, but when they first meet Lucas, it's huge. It's just glorious in the, you know, and then it continues while they search for his room, which I'm so proud of that.
Yeah.
I'm like, you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of a joke where the guy's got home late from golfing with his buddy Bob. And he goes, we were late because Bob had a heart attack on the ninth hole.
Oh my goodness. God,
is he okay? He goes, yeah, he's fine. And he goes, well, something like, I don't know how it ends up, but his bottom line is why it took so long for them to get home is like, you know, we had to hit a ball and drag Bob. We had to hit a ball and drag Bob, man. Hit a ball and drag Bob. So that reminds me of that joke, you know?
It's yes, like, it does.
Check the door, drag Lucas. Check the door, drag Lucas.
It was so painfully funny because you're just like, oh, this is so terrible, but you're kidding. Oh, I'm laughing.
And like, I wanted to drag that out. You know, I didn't want to make that quick. I wanted to see them hit a lot of doors.
Yes. It reminded me of Weekend at Bernie's there for a while.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I never thought of that, but you're absolutely right. Yeah. My friend and my partner too, one, he's not a Star Wars fan, Justin Eskew. And what he really liked about it, he says to this day, it's one of the funniest scripts he's ever read. But what he loved about it was all the movie references.
Yes. Your Agent Smith was perfect.
Oh, he was great, wasn't he?
He was perfect.
Jason Wickenkamp. I had no idea he was going to do such a great job. But yeah. And I was going to say, too, all of the stuff that he mentions in there, they've got that file on Woody. And all the stuff that he mentions in there, like you ordered a Don Post studio, but they returned your money when they ran out of masks and you never reordered. That's true. I did that. I did mutilate all of my Star Wars action figures, making a little Super 8 stop motion movie. I can't even remember all the other stuff, but that's all true. That's all from my life. So, but he was amazing. And, you know, we wanted to play that scene exactly as it was, you know, in The Matrix, but, you know, for laughs.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
But, you know, I mean, but I threw in as many of just my favorite movies as I can. You know, there's clearly a Godfather scene in there. There's trying to think if there was a Braveheart scene, but I did.
Yeah.
Our poster is the Braveheart tagline. You know, and Braveheart was every man dies, but not every man truly lives. And so our tagline.
I hadn't thought of that.
Every saga has a beginning, but not every saga has to end. That's what it was.
Yeah.
My own tagline, you know. And of course, the Saving Private Ryan, you know, poster.
Oh yes, very much.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I can't. There was a lot of airplane references in there. We do Harry Potter.
Yes.
We do. If you love movies, and that's the thing, I don't think you have to be a Star Wars fan to like this movie. I think if you're a Star Wars fan, you're going to get a lot of the jokes and the references.
Right.
quotes, you know, I mean, the dirty hair, to me, one of the funniest parts is Hank with the lightsaber and the dirty hair, you know, this is a lightsaber, and take your head clean off.
Yeah, and the funny part is it's a plastic toy that he's got the whole time. Like, really? You're going to take his head off with a plastic toy?
Yeah. And you know what? That's another good point, too, is I learned so much just from watching movies and listening to interviews. And, you know, and back in the day, you had to read them, you know.
Yeah.
Now there's podcasts. Things. Well, I was worried, and other people were worried about people not taking the lightsaber battle seriously, you know, and like, but the reality is they're not going to kill you, but they hurt like a mother if you get hit in the ear with one of those things, you know.
Yeah, you could sting them
or get slapped in the thigh, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
So there's that. So, you know, basically, in the reality is they're not going to kill each other, but you don't want to get hit. So they're fighting for reals.
Yeah.
So, and I didn't want to go again. I wanted to be in the real world. So I did not have a problem. I was never, ever tempted to use real lightsaber, not real lightsabers, but, you know, the glowy lightsabers.
Right.
But I had read an interview years ago with Ivan Reitman, and he was talking about Ghostbusters. He was talking about the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. And he said, during the test audiences and the premieres or whatever, he was in the back of the theater watching the movie. And it's like, and here comes the point. He said, when the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man appeared, he said, either they were going to go absolutely freaking nuts or they were going to rip the seats out of the theater and come after him. Said, but he didn't know what he said. But he said his hope was that if he had them the whole movie and built it up the correct way, they'll go with them anywhere. They'll mm-hmm. take that big leap. If not, then he lost them a long time ago. It wasn't the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. It was he lost them, you know, an hour ago.
Yeah.
And so, you know, he said, you know, Dan Aykroyd says, the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. And then there's silence. And he said, oh, crap. And then the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man appears. And the theater just exploded, you know?
Yeah.
So he's like, yep, got him. And so that was my hope with the lightsaber battle.
Yeah.
Was that if they go and they, oh, this is stupid, you know, then I lost them a long time ago. But if we did it correctly and we slowly build up to it and we take our time getting into that, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just a ton of fun, you know? And we've all been there, you know? We've all had lightsabers.
Even if it was a wiffle ball bat, you know, we'd fight with those. And those would sting when you get hit.
Back in the day, you know, it was treatment. Sticks.
Yeah.
And that's another thing I'd like to go back and do would be shoot a scene showing the young Woody and Hank lightsaber battling with sticks and doing the
moves
to see that originate, you know. So getting to that, what we're trying to do now is we want to go back. Here's the thing. It's a low-budget film, right? But it was shot with 15-year-old technology. Now, things are so much better. DSL cameras, you know, we can get the depth of field. We've learned a lot. Excuse me. So what I wanted to do, and the kid that plays young Taylor, or actually, yeah, the kid that plays Taylor Garrison, the son that was dying, he's now 15 years older. He's an adult. So what I want to do is I want to go back and reshoot the opening scene, the Saving Private Ryan, and the end scene. I want to shoot it shot for shot, Saving Private Ryan. I want to use the real the Scott Heffern, who played Taylor Garrison. I want to use him as an adult to shoot that. So giving it two things. One, giving it an actual 15-year gap.
Yeah.
But it'll also, if we shoot it really, really well, by today's technology, the beginning and the ending will look great because it's present day, right?
Right.
Then when we flash back to the main body of the film 15 years ago, it'll have kind of that reverse Wizard of Oz feel, you know?
Yeah.
It literally will be 15 years ago.
And right.
It will... People won't necessarily look at it as poor lighting, poor sound. They'll look at it as like, well, this is a 15-year-old movie. <You know? laughs> So that's the plan. And of course, Woody and Hank, Jim and Joe, are also 15 years older. Mm-hmm. So we'll put them in the opening in the in scenes as well, so you can kind of see their age and progression. So so I think, and then like I said, if I can add the scene with the kids doing the move, and the lightsaber battle after they've seen the movie, and also insert me as Max into that first scene where you see Lucas. Then that's a special edition, and we'll never stop tinkering with it. It's a very special edition.
There you go.
Yeah, so that's the plan. In the meantime, we're also we had made a second film, which was called Open Micers. It's not available online yet. Actually, it is, but it's private. Which I'll send you a link so you can take a look at it. But Cindy Morgan of Caddyshack and Tron is
wow.
in that one. And
wow.
Yeah, she was a lot of fun to work with. It is a kind of a mockumentary style, like The Office, or, you know, it's like, I call it Best in Show set in a comedy club. and it's about a group of amateur comedians that are trying to win a slot as a house MC at a club. And this kind of deranged Dr. Strangelove type of comedy guru, self-proclaimed comedy, puts him through all these weird paces, you know, to try to teach them and everything. So, excuse me. So, I'll show you that one. Then, right now, our biggest thrust right now, working on a documentary. It's a comedy documentary, and it's called Steve Martin versus Terre Haute, Indiana, which is it is a true story. And I don't know if you're aware of this or not. Back in '79, Steve Martin was, you know, he was the first stadium comedian. He played, you know, stadiums all over the country. And Playboy magazine, he did an interview with Playboy magazine, and they asked him what was the most nowhere town in America. He immediately said Terre Haute, Indiana. And he said, because one, it smells, it's a smelly town. Two, there's absolutely nothing open downtown to eat or to do anything after like 6 or 7 o'clock. And the radio, the television stations, like 3 stations, and they're all fuzzy. And I basically just got a lot of fertilizer commercials. So when Terre Haute got wind of this, they said, well, okay, all that may be true, but we've got some good things too. So long story short, they actually invited Steve Martin to come back, and it happened to coincide with the release of Jerk. So he took them up on it. He came back, and they basically spent the day just messing with him, just giving him a hard time. They gave him a rental car with busted out windows. They took him through their first brand new automatic car wash. There's a notorious train track crossing there that's, you know, you can spend an hour waiting the trains there. So they got him hung up there. They took him a tour of the ammonia plant, which made fertilizer. They took him to Jones and Beebe's tractor sales and repair, and they gave him a $10 gift certificate that he could spend on whatever he wanted. What else did they do? But you see, you know, so they had a sense of humor about it, right?
Yeah.
So all's well, he gives a speech, and he's like, you know, I see the error of my ways, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, Terre Haute does not know where the USA. He goes, Noverville, USA is actually Albuquerque. So, and he also said since he was so wrong, he's going to have the world premiere of The Jerk in Terre Haute, Indiana, which he did.
Mm.
So all is well. They all go their separate ways. Fast forward to, I think it was 80, 81, with the movie Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid. At the end of Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid, the Nazi, played by Carl Reiner, is trying to destroy the world with the Nazi cheese mold. And he only succeeds, because Steve Martin foils him, he only succeeds in destroying Terre Haute, Indiana. And Steve Martin says, damn, and they were about to get a public library. So, and then he went on the Steve Allen show, and he actually showed the footage of him going to Terre Haute, and again, completely kept making fun of Terre Haute, you know, this and that. It's just this constant lighthearted feud, and it's been going on for 40 years now.
Wow.
As recently as 2013, he was interviewed in the Indianapolis Star when he was nearby. And they asked him about it, and he goes, "Yeah, that was a fun excursion." He goes, "But I'm sure Terre Haute has two-story buildings by now." So he just keeps picking at him. So we're going to make this documentary that's going to relate all that in a funny way. We're going to be very exaggerating about it, you know, like Steve Martin really is a jerk. You know, we're going to appeal to his sense of humor and also. I'm working with the city council. I'm working with the Indiana State University Alumni Foundation. And we're trying really hard to get an official invitation to have him back, because for one thing is the factories and things that made Terre Haute smell, which it was a renowned, infamous smell. Everyone knows Terre Haute smells, or did. They're all gone. All the factories are gone. So this town doesn't stink anymore. They've got cable. And there's a nightlife downtown now. So all of that, they want to come back and see how they've grown, but they're also, well, I'm trying to get them to like rename something in his honor. Like, for example, the Crossroads of America goes through Terre Haute, Indiana, US 40 and something else. And there's a manhole cover there, and that's my favorite idea, because I would just love to say Steve Martin's manhole, you know. And have a manhole cover that's, you know, it's dedicated to the Steve Martin manhole or whatever, right? The more appropriate one might be, though, I'm trying to talk to them about renaming their library the Steve Martin Public Library.
Yeah.
Considering
what he's joking about. Yes.
Yes. And get him to come. Get him to be there for that. Also, now with his band, we'll give his band a job. We'll bring them in to play.
Yeah.
You know? And since it is the 40th anniversary of The Jerk, what better way to, you know, celebrate that with where it started? Since they have
right.
him here, why not have a 40th anniversary showing with him in attendance? So we're hoping all this is going to come together. However it comes together or doesn't, we'll make the story.
There you go.
You know. Oh, the other thing too, what we're going to do, this is actually great. In the trailer for Deadman Dentler Platt, it's hilarious. You can look this up online, trailer Deadman Dentler Platt. Steve Martin said, "Hey, I made two movies this summer or this year, and you're going to see one of them in the theaters this summer. Your seats are electronically wired to this buttometer. Simply by registering your vote, you can, or by tensing your buttocks, you can register your vote." Because so the first movie is shot on location in Terre Haute, Indiana, called Manure for the Millions. And the other one was Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid, a comedy thriller, you know, directed by Carl Reiner. So he asks them, he goes, "All those who want to see Manure for the Millions shot on location in Terre Haute, Indiana, tense your buttocks now." So, you know, it goes a little bit, you know, and then who wants to see Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid? That's this song. So, the thing is, though, obviously he did not make Manure Millions in Terre Haute,
right.
Indiana. No. So, why? You know what? After 40 years, we kind of think that it's time to make Manure for the Millions, then we're going to shoot it in Terre Haute. So we're going to make that movie. Now, can we get Steve Martin in it even for a minute? Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. If he comes, then yeah. You know?
That would be funny.
Yeah, so we'll also be part of the documentary, you know, the movie, and then when that's all said and done, we'll have a movie. And actually, what we're doing right now with that is we are using Seed and Spark. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but it's kind of like a Kickstarter.
Oh, okay.
So do their own distribution if you want to. Well, your audience with you. So, audience for this movie, and also we're going to put the Saving Star Wars redo on there. Next movie that I decided to make, our audience is already there. They follow us, you know, with it. So, will send you the link to that. Right now, we're in preview. We're not have money. I'm just asking for followers. The more followers we get, the more resources we unlock. Queen Spark. Our first goal is 250 followers. Our second goal is 500. So each one of those levels gives us certain resources through Seed and Spark. So the more followers we can get, the better.
Awesome.
So I'll send you for that, and also I'll send you our Facebook. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, and you know we're really gearing up right now. Like I said, we're taking our time with this one. We want to get right. The only deadlines are the ones we impose on ourselves.
There you go.
So you know, we got all the time in the world, and as long as nobody dies on us, then you know, we've got that time. So
yeah,
pretty excited about that, and I would encourage everyone to jump on board with that one, just to follow the project because it's going to be hilarious.
You know,
even if ultimately if you don't participate in terms of $10 or whatever, just follow us because it's going to be a blast. So and there's on Facebook we've got a production notes group. We've also got a Lunch with Gary group, which we're going to be starting up here real soon, where every day, Monday through Friday, I'm going to do a live broadcast at lunch. I usually don't eat, so I'm either working or taking care of things, you know, and just kind of talk and have special guests and, you know, just kind of make that a fun thing too. So right now, anybody can join those groups. Once we go live on Seed and Spark, they'll be part of the funding process. So you'll have to throw some money into the hat to get on. So I'll send you all those links if you could pass those on. That would be awesome. And we don't have the Star Wars one up going yet, the Saving Star Wars, but we're going to be getting that one too. So I will there's a Saving Star Wars Facebook page, which is very active. Twitter not as active, but we're on there. So they can always find Saving Star Wars on Facebook and Twitter, too. And keep, like those pages and follow the Twitter page, and they'll get information on that as well when we're headed to do that one. So hopefully we're going to shoot that this summer as well.
Awesome.
Because we'll be shooting the Steve Martin Terre Haute documentary late summer into fall and probably into winter a little bit, too. Because that's when he came in December, if I remember right. So we're probably going to try to hit that same 40-year anniversary. So.
Time out! The Great Space Coaster will return after these messages!
C-3PO.
Loki.
Mace Windu.
Dr. Bruce Banner.
Captain Rex.
Venom.
Princess Leia.
Jean Grey.
Darth Maul.
Nick Fury.
Grand Moff Tarkin.
Captain America.
Lando Calrissian.
Cyclops.
What do all these characters have in common?
Well, two of them were played by Samuel L. Jackson.
A couple of them were played by Hammer Films veterans Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee.
Come on, guys. You know this.
Well, of course we do, Jessica. Just like Mickey Mouse and Captain Jack Sparrow, they're all now Disney characters. Hello, I'm Tracy of the Disney Indiana podcast, and my co-host Scott and I enjoy talking about all aspects of the House of Mouse, and that includes their newest properties, Marvel and LucasArts.
We also talk about Disney resorts, the cruise line, theme parks, and whatever else Mickey has to offer.
Which includes movies, Imagineering, video games, and collectibles. You'll never know what we'll decide to talk about.
So check us out at www.disneyindiana.com or do a search for the Disney Indiana podcast on iTunes, because now we've got a lot more to talk about.
And don't forget about those other quote-unquote Disney characters like, well, Sully.
Fozzie Bear.
Buzz Lightyear.
Link Hogthrob.
Doug.
Janice.
Merida.
Pepe.
Bruce.
Ralph the Dog.
Wally.
Dr. The Disney Bunsen Indiana Honeydew. Podcast. Syndrome. Even after Bella. 5 years, we're still miles away from the nearest Main Street, USA. We're not listed on the map, but you can join us at www.disneyindiana.com.
I'm in! Now back to the program!
America did not exist. 4 centuries of work, bloodshed, loneliness, and fear created this land. We built America, and the process made us Americans. A new breed, rooted in all races, stained and tinted with all colors, a seeming ethnic anarchy. Then, in a little time, we became more alike than we were different. A new society. Not great, but fitted by our very faults for greatness. Excuse me, Mr. Twain.
What's that?
Perhaps you recognize those inspiring words from one of America's great writers.
No, Dr. Franklin, I don't recall writing anything like that.
Oh, my, of course not. They're from the pen of John Steinbeck, back in the 20th century. Why, it seems he has nearly the same spirit as the founding fathers themselves.
Well, listen to the proud elder statesman.
Mr. Twain, pride is one of our national passions. Even those who overcome it are proud of their humility.
Easy now. I was born modest. Fortunately, it wore off. Dr. Franklin is our genuine American antique. I suppose our story begins with you.
Actually, it started long before even my time. It started when dreams and visions of a new world were shrouded in the myths and legends of an old world. Finally, through those early mists of uncertainty, sailed the first great adventurers. This tiny ship is the Mayflower, carrying pilgrims in search of their dream, a dream of religious freedom. So, if you'll pardon an old man's pride, for me, this is the beginning of the American adventure.
This ocean I'm waiting to see, a land for these people who dream to be free. So stand by the mainsail, the fierce storms will race. Aloft with ye mates, our King Neptune will face. You'd think that these landlubbers never would last, this cargo of pilgrims 12 weeks for the mast. It's land ho, me hearties, at last we've arrived, and praise be to God, nearly all have survived. But a look o'er this wilderness brings me to dread that the first bitter winter may leave all more dead. They call themselves pilgrims, these poor wretched souls with a dream to be free in the new world their goal.
Yes, far from welcoming the early settlers, this land severely challenged them. It was a struggle for survival that gained but a tiny toehold in a vast, untamed wilderness. In the decades that followed, a new challenge began to emerge. We were growing more and more apart from the mother country. Passion began to govern, and she never governs wisely.
Ha! The British think it's fools we be. If they tax our trade, then our land be next, and soon all else we possess.
Hear me now. You ask defense against the French and the Indians. Should you not help pay for it?
Parliament's colonial policy is both arbitrary and unjust.
That's nonsense. The same tea that costs you 3 shillings a pound costs us 6.
First, we spoke out with our voices. Then, we spoke out with action, with a growing defiance that led to the Boston Tea Party.
Hear ye! Hear ye! By royal proclamation, His Majesty King George III hereby sets...
Look at this! They're closing the harbor!
But surely we can work something out. Our king feels we've wronged him.
Your king, you Tory! Either we cut the ties with England or we surrender our liberty!
Finally, the time had come to speak with one voice in a declaration of independence. Ah, good evening, Mr. Jefferson. Have you finished the new draft yet?
Those are new drafts all over the floor, Dr. Franklin.
It seems one stroke of this pen brings two changes from Congress. I told you John Adams should have written this.
Oh, by his own admission, you can write circles around him.
Mr. Adams has not been prisoner in this loft for 17 days. I shall continue tomorrow.
You must continue now. Thomas, it is difficult to make 13 clocks chime at the same time, but we must carefully justify this separation.
Dr. Franklin, while you slept soundly through the meeting this afternoon, we did manage to justify separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
I shan't spend another night up here.
At least you got shoes, mate. There's not a dozen left what can say that.
Ah, don't tell me, friend. Tell the good general there. Tell him that half his camp has got typhus, smallpox, or dysentery.
And there be not a ration amongst us. Now we can forage for hickory nuts.
Aye, while the English overindulge in our Philadelphia's fine food and drink.
Tis a strange war we shoulder, George Washington. Congress sleeps warmly in York.
And the British party in Philadelphia.
And we freeze or starve to death here in Valley Forge. In the end, we the people prevailed and achieved perhaps our greatest dream. 13 very different colonies became the United States of America, and we were free to become an entire nation of dreamers and doers.
Westward bound, Dr. Franklin, to new frontiers.
To the age of Samuel Langhorne Clemens.
Well, I like to think Mark Twain was part of all that. Yes, sir, Dr. Franklin. You founding fathers gave us a pretty good start, don't you know? We still had some things to learn the hard way. Seems a whole bunch of folks found out we the people didn't yet mean all the people. Folks like Frederick Douglass.
Even amidst the cricket song here along Mark Twain's beloved Mississippi, I hear the noise of chains and the crack of the whip. Yet, there is hope. Hope born from the words of Harriet Beecher Stowe. Uncle Tom's cabin has given our nation a key, which can unlock the slave prison to millions. Anti-slavery is no longer a thing to be prevented. It is grown too abundant to be snuffed out like a lantern.
Troublemakers like Douglass got us into this mess.
He only wanted freedom, not war.
Well, listen to my abolitionist brother.
What?
Pa, he's gonna make a real good
Billy Yank. We got a good cause, Johnny Reb.
Quiet, both of you. You're gonna ruin Ma's birthday.
No, no. Ain't nothing gonna ruin today. We're all together. That's what counts. Now, you go ahead, Mr. Brady.
All right, everybody. Hold real still now.
Two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, one wore blue and one wore gray. One wore blue and one wore gray as they marched along their way. The fife and drum began to play all on a beautiful morning. One was gentle, one was kind. One was gentle, one was kind. One came home, one stayed behind. A cannonball don't pay no mind. Cannonball, don't pay no mind if you're gentle or if you're kind. It don't think of the folks behind, all on a beautiful morning. All on a beautiful morning.
At last, a terrible civil war ended. The time had come to rebuild our shattered nation. And a new wave of immigrants would help us do it. From around the world they came, these new Americans. A thousand noble currents, wrote Herman Melville, all pouring into one. Seems there was a new dawn coming for the American adventure.
Enough! Enough of your words! Let your new dawn lead to the final sunset on my people's suffering. When I think of our condition, my heart is heavy. I see men of my own race treated as outlaws or shot down like animals. I hope that all of us may be brothers, with one country around us and one government for all. From where the sun now stands, I will fight no more. Forever.
The wisdom of the great Chief Joseph reminded us once again of our long, painful journey through the frontiers of human liberty.
Woman has shown equal devotion with man to the cause of freedom. Country, what it is. We ask justice. We ask equality be guaranteed to us and our daughters forever.
Well, here we are, back in the heat of Franklin's Philadelphia again. We're 100 years old today. It came a long way in that first century. But like Susan B. Anthony, we're still speaking out.
And why shouldn't we, Mr. Twain?
As Tom Edison says, discontent is the first necessity of progress.
Edison, afraid I don't place the name.
Edison's that young phonograph inventor. Why, this great hall is filled with new inventions. There's Otis Elevator, Corliss Magnificent Steam Engines.
And don't forget me telephone, the true hallmark of progress.
Aha! Behold the proud Scots.
That's right. Carnegie Steel built this place.
Aye, and it'll soon build a new concert hall for New York.
Oh, Carnegie Hall, eh? It'll never last. But donating libraries... Andy, that's a grand idea.
is an age for grand ideas.
An era for innovation.
A dawn for new awareness.
A time to challenge the frontiers of a new century. Yes, sir. We soared into the 20th century on the wings of invention and the winds of change. But our America the Beautiful, she was changing too. We needed people like Teddy Roosevelt and an outspoken naturalist, John Muir, to get our attention.
Beautiful. Bully beautiful. Those falls are magnificent.
Aye, Mr. President. But it won't last if the timber thieves have their way.
John, you may be right, but the country's growth is putting a tremendous demand on our resources.
Any fool can destroy trees. Why, for more than 3,000 years, God has cared for our giant sequoias, saved them from drought, disease, avalanches, and floods. But he cannot save them from fools.
Now, John, you know I can't ask lumbering to stop completely.
All I ask is that we stop massive destruction. What will our children inherit? Seedlings?
Of course not. I realize we're not building this country for a generation alone. I know we've got to expand our parks.
Then start it here and now. Make this valley a part of Yosemite National Park.
Well, I guess we needed those national parks. Seems the simple life of my day was slipping away. Ready or not, we were soon thrust into the hectic role of a world leader and into the war to end all wars.
More than 33 grueling, non-stop hours after his departure from New York, Captain Charles Augustus Lindbergh successfully landed his Spirit of St. Louis in Paris last week. Lucky Lindy's solo flight across the Atlantic has certainly placed him among the greatest in a long line of American pioneers.
Today, October 29th, 1929, Wall Street became America's greatest wall of rubble. This stock market crash has tarnished the golden dreams of millions.
Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Spare a dime? Sure. Buy four of my apples, and I'll loan you back to 10 cents.
Hey, Sam, I heard tell there's New York millionaires are selling apples, too.
You means ex-millionaires, don't you?
Hey, it looks like the storm is finally letting up. Well, maybe the Sunday drivers will come out hunting for gas.
Ain't many folks should pay no 18 cents a gallon.
Hey, listen, fellas. Old FDR's been inaugurated.
The whole truth,
frankly and boldly, this great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive, and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
Yeah, I sure hope he's right. Folks could use a little prosperity around these parts.
Yes, sir. Before this depression,
We sure had enjoyed special blessings.
Hold it.
But you
I
know,
think it's
it
Will
seems
Rogers.
To me that we was a mighty cocky nation. We'd begun to believe that the height of civilization was an automobile, a radio, and a bathtub. Of course, now we're a whole lot smarter. Now Congress wants to trim down the Navy so it'll fit into the bathtub, too. You know, it seems to me like we're the only nation in the world that waits till we get into a war before we start getting ready for it.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces.
Yes, that was dedicated to you, Rosie. Tens of thousands of you across the face of America working tonight to keep our boys in the fight. To all of you out there, a very Merry Christmas.
Well, Rosie, think you'll ever get this old top back in the fight?
We'll sure try, Sailor. Hey, what did you fellas do? Let the whole Nazi fleet use you for target practice?
Yeah, no wonder they got us working double shifts. Great way to celebrate the holidays with our guys over there.
Cheer up, Jane. Maybe we'll all be together by next Christmas.
Yeah.
Mr. Twain. What do you think of our America now?
I think the Founding Fathers never dreamed of an America like this.
Of course not. We weren't dreamers. We were visionaries. That is why our Constitution withstands the rigors of time.
Easy now, Dr. Franklin. This nation's still just a youngster, don't you know? Why, some countries have been around for 50 centuries. We're barely into our third.
That's true, but look what we've accomplished in that tiny span of time.
My dear doctor, earlier you found John Steinbeck so inspiring, but he also sounded this warning. We now face the danger which in the past has been the most destructive to the human: success, plenty, comfort, and ever-increasing leisure. No dynamic people has ever survived these dangers.
I may have invented these bifocals I'm wearing, but I can assure you they are not rose-colored. Mr. Twain, the Golden Age never was the present age, but with human liberty, we can fulfill the promise and meaning of America. To everyone a chance, believed Thomas Wolfe. To all people, regardless of their birth, the right to live, to work, to be themselves, and to become whatever their visions can combine to make them. This is the promise of America. Mr. Twain, 'tis easy to see, hard to foresee, but I foresee the American adventure to continue a long, long time.
America!
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast.
We invite you back next week for more fun and adventure.
Until then, remember to keep a pixie in your pocket.
It's that young at heart, positive attitude that you can share with others.
And remember to visit our website at neverlandpodcast.com.
There you can find links to our news page, our shop,
our contact page, where you can easily send an email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com.
You can also find our Neverlanders page, where you can find out how to become an official Lost Boy or Pixie, because girls are too clever to get lost.
Become a real Neverlander.
Please feel free to leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492.
And be sure to follow us on Twitter at NeverlandPCast.
And like our Neverland Podcast fan page on Facebook.
We also have a group on Facebook for you to join.
We also appreciate your support to keep the Neverland Podcast up and running.
Visit patreon.com/neverlandpodcast to donate to keeping the pixie dust alive.
Copyright content featured on the Neverland Podcast is copyright of their respective creators and used under fair use license.
All original content is copyright of Blue Band Productions, and a very special thanks to Yeehaw Bob Jackson at yeehawbob.com for our new ending music.
God bless!
Yeah! Hello, everybody! This is Yeehaw Bob Jackson.
Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast.